Would you shut up a minute, please?
Go ahead.
As I said, please. Well-mannered in his country, which is more than can be said for the people who come here.
Well, Graham Gooch is playing today.
Speaks very highly of you. You done a follow-up to Bat Out of Hell?
In the Nat West Trophy.
Why the follow-up, and why now? Answer the questions!
Well, we did it when it was right to do it.
Oh, what a boring, boring answer.
No, that's not a boring answer. What did you want me to say? You want me to lie to you?
Yeah.
Well, I'm not
gonna. You can say you were broke and needed the money. You thought it was a nice idea.
Well, all of those are true. First of all, since you brought up the one subject, I never have done anything for the money. I have never, ever done anything for the money, and I will never do anything for the money. I have, like, turned down millions of dollars because, you know, you say no to certain things that you don't, that, boy, it's early in the morning for me, that that are not artistically correct for people, that are, you know, and I always remain true to myself, and I'll never sell myself out. So there you go.
So come on, then. What's the real reason for doing?
No, because, well, first of all, Jim and I made a great record when we made this one. You've got one in your hand over here with this red cover, this Bat Out of Hell, and it was really very special and very magic. And in 86, we decided that we should do another one, and it came out in 93. I can't help it if it took 7 years.
So why did it take 7 years?
Well, first of all, people were very skeptical of the fact, you know, oh, he can't sing anymore, he can't do this anymore, oh, he's, you know. And then they got off to me and they would go, oh, he's weird. It's a Steinman. He's weird. He can't write songs anymore. His last song was Total Eclipse of the Heart that Bonnie Tyler did. He hadn't written anything since then. He can't write. You know, it's not going to work. Well, maybe it'll work. Can we hear something? No, we don't do that. Either you take us or you don't. And so Arista Records was the first, because I was signed to Arista, said, oh, no, I don't know. We don't want a Meatloaf Jim Steinman record. First of all, he's crazy. You know, it'll cost him too much money. No, we don't want to. No. We don't want to. I said, what are you, nuts? What are you, completely loony? Are you people, you lost your mind? And they go, don't talk to us that way. Okay, fine, I won't. Bye. So we left, and then we went over back to our friends at Sony CBS, and we said to them, would you like to have the follow-up to Bat Out of Hell 2? And they went, yeah, good, great idea. I said, okay, that's terrific. Can we talk about the money you owe us that you haven't paid us since 1980? What money? Well, you know, the money that you haven't paid Jim. And I, in fact, you haven't even sent us one of those little things that tell us how many records you sold since 1980. Yes, we have. No, you really haven't done that. Well, but what about our back row? We don't owe you anything. Well, then you don't really want this record. We do, but we don't owe you. Well, then you can't have this record unless you do that. So then that went around for a little while. And then finally, the guy who was interested in signing us over at Sony left and went to MCA in America named Al Teller. So when he left there, he called us up about, you know, and said, look, I'm now at MCA. I would like to sign you over here. And I said, oh, my heavens, MCA. Well, they're okay in America, but yike. I don't think I want to be on MCA International. Now, listen, all you people at MCA that might hear this, it's nothing personal. It's absolutely nothing personal. It's just your boss. So, anyway, but you're editing that out, I know. So, anyway, well, then, pay attention to me in here. Don't be talking to her. So, anyway, if you want to talk to her, come in here and talk to her. It's... nothing's ruder than having people whisper behind your back. So anyway, so then I went and talked to Virgin, and then So I said, well, I don't want to be MCA International. I don't want to be MCA. So we were looking for a worldwide deal. So then we went to Virgin, and Virgin around the world said, oh, man, yeah. Oh, yeah, come on. Come on in. They put their arms around us and said, yeah, yeah, man, this is good. This is a great idea. And so then we went to Virgin in America, and they said, Meatloaf, what are you kidding? Meatloaf's not hip. And I went, oh, that's the first right thing you've said yet. And I'll never be hip either. And you remember that. And so so as it turned out, we signed with MCA in America. And we signed with Virgin for the rest of the world. And there you go. See, that wasn't a short answer or boring.
It was so rambling, though. It just went on and on and on.
Yes, but it was all to the point.
Well, near enough. We can slow down the edit anyway. Yet some members of the E Street Band on the first one. Now, they're looking for a bit of work at the moment.
No, well, Roy's
are they
not.
On the second one?
Just Roy. But Roy's another one not looking for work. See, that's how it goes. It's either feast or famine, isn't it? No matter who you are, the E Street Band, Max came in and played on Bat at Hell. Nah, he's out of Bruce Brand. I don't want Max Weinberg anymore. No, that had nothing to do with it. Max hurt his hand, and he just didn't hit as hard as he used to. I mean, he was a great drummer, and I would have used him again. But, you know, times change. And so we did use Roy, and I fought with Roy, like I always do. I fight with Roy Bittan. It's just one of those things. It's like, let's think what that's like. Who would fight? A cat and a dog. You know? What else fights? Come on, tell me.
Meatloaf and various people in the studio. Are you a really horrible person to work with, anyway?
Absolutely
really
not.
Unpleasant.
No, absolutely not. Most of the people that work for me are have been working with me for a long time. And I am very loyal to the people. And they whenever we call, say we're going out on the road, they come. Like all my crew. All, you know, from the guitar techs down to the monitor guys, to the light guys, to the riggers. No, we do great tours. They never get bored on the tours. The band's never bored. The crew's never bored because the crew doesn't know what's going to happen next when we do a tour, when we do a show.
Do you know what's going to happen next?
Absolutely not. I mean, yeah, I do know exactly what's going to happen next. But most of my stuff is based on improv. And so, and I have a real foundation in it, so I'm not guessing. But I do kind of go on a conscious, unconscious flow. So I kind of let it go. But it's all very, it's very controlled and very planned. And it's like any good improv. Like, there's this show in America and in England. It's an English show where there's three or four improv people that Clive Anderson MC'd, or what are they presented? That's it. They call them presenters. MC, and now those guys, I watch them, and they're very good. But all their improvs, they have a base from all that stuff. So it is improv, but there's rules of the game for improv. So anyway. But live, I'm not going to let you ask me another question just yet. I saw you heading for that piece of paper. I'm not through yet. So, but live, I keep the band on its toes. The band is never bored. I also have taught them stuff that I've taught them that going out on stage is more than walking on a wooden floor. And it is, there's a way of doing it. It's like you hear people that may have seen an act two or three times, maybe four, maybe five, and they go, well, it was really magic at this place, right? It was really magical there. But now I've seen them four or five times, and it's sort of like, they sort of seem like that, you know, it's kind of doing the same thing, and that, you know, it's like, so it's not inspired. And what's happened is, in the pop world, people take out these shows sometimes that are very controlling. They could, you know, they'll take out certain staging and they'll take out certain things that control the flow. But that's not unlike theater at all. Everything is very controlled in theater. But there's a trick in theater. There's a trick as an actor. Any stage actor will tell you that it's your job to make that character walk on stage as if it's the first time every night. That way, the audience always feels that it's the first time every night. And there's a, you know, most rock performers, I won't say all, but I'm saying most rock performers don't know, and I think that's a responsibility they should know. If they're going to say that we're going to go on tour and we're going to take the stage, they should learn the craft. And I really believe that. I think that they should know that the stage is more than a floor.
But you're saying that you control this improvisation, so you're using the same control you're arguing against.
No, I'm not. No, because you don't. It's not controlled. It's you have a foundation for it. You can't build a house without a foundation. So each night the house is different, but the foundation remains the same because you have to. You have to have foundation. It's like you have to know the chords you're going to play to be able to sing the song. But that doesn't mean that you have to have, you can't play the song loud or soft. It doesn't mean that you can't extend the 8-bar section. That doesn't mean that you can't stop it in the middle and do something and start again. That doesn't mean that this particular night you can keep the band playing the same chord for about 30 minutes. All of that. That's improv, but it's all has a foundation. You know the places where you can and only the places you can't. But it's totally not controlled. But you just like anything, if you're Robert De Niro and you're gonna go play the character that he played in Cape Fear, you have had to do something to base that character on. You have had to build that character, you've had to create that character. But once that character is created and built, you don't know where that character can turn once you let him go.
All right. That'll do for me. God, don't you go on. All right.
This is a long interview. You want me to give you short answers? We'll be out of here in four seconds.
No. There's a quote.
I can't wait for this. Another one of my quotes.
Meatloaf's hard-rocking power appeals and tongue-in-cheek attitude to a larger-than-life image. But
who said that?
How much of it? I was in some old book I found. In fact, one book you weren't even in. It went straight from McCartney to Mellencamp. You weren't even in it.
There you go.
There you go. It's taste, isn't it? So, I mean, how
was
much
it
of
written
it
by
is
Dave
image?
Marsh?
That's you off the Christmas card list. I mean, how much of it is image and how much of it is the real person? You appear to be so much larger than life and a very noisy drinker.
That's only.
All right.
It's hot. What do you do with your hot tea? Don't you go?
I'll let it cool. So how much of this?
Well, if you want to drink, what's okay? Then why you get hot tea?
Come on, answer that question. Why
I'm asking you a question now. Why do you drink hot tea if you let it cool? Why don't you drink cold tea?
No, it's awful. Awful. Worst thing you can do. So how much of this is?
Well,
image,
then, what's the worst thing you can do?
Answer my question now.
No, I want to question you. You said I don't drink hot tea. I don't drink hot tea.
When you let it cool.
When it's
the appropriate temperature, you don't drink it. That's manners.
You want it warm.
That's manners.
No, it's not.
You're slurping it all over the place.
I didn't slurp. I went.
Which is slurp?
Not where I come from.
We won't continue that conversation. So come on, how much of this is image and how much is you? I mean, yeah, okay, this is very fine and very impressive, but I mean, you know.
What is?
The Meatloaf image. How much of it is you and how much of it is completely contrived?
Oh, there's nothing ever contrived. Now, that would be like saying to Robert De Niro, who's one of my favorite actors, by the way.
I've never guessed.
That Jake LaMotta in Raging Bull was contrived. And I wouldn't say that to Robert De Niro if I were you. I would never say that to him. Now, me, on the other hand, you can ask me that question, and I really won't tump this table over on top of you, but don't ever do an interview with Robert De Niro and bring that question up. Let me just tell you that now.
Thank you for the advice. I respect that tremendously. While we're on acting.
No, we're going to go back to your question. You want an answer to your question. I'm going to give you an answer to your question. Nothing is contrived. There are characters, and I like the fact that these characters exist and that no one that I tend to be have an image of a certain thing because I don't live that way, so the image lives for me. And it's fine. I like whatever image that anybody wants to give me, as long as they spell my name right. That goes back to the P.T. Barnum theory of show business, which is make sure that my name is two words if you're going to put it down on a piece of paper. Because that's the only thing that will drive me nuts. And everywhere I go, I've been seeing it lately as one word, even at the Virgin Record Company, fix it. And then, so I just go, can't you see the front of the album cover? It's two words. It's very simple to figure that out, right? All you got to do is just look. And so that's the only thing that drives me crazy. But other than that, anything that they want to say about me is fine. And anything that anybody wants to write about me is fine. Just spell my name right.
So, Mr. Meat Loaf?
No, just Mr. Loaf or Meat.
Okay.
Would you call...
Mr. Robert De Niro? Yes, I would.
But would you call him... Okay, you would call him that. All right, I'm not going to argue
so would
you.
You.
Okay. Let's call him Bob.
Let's briefly touch on the music. But, of course, you're that close to Rob.
I never met him.
But he speaks very highly of you.
Well, I know that.
Rock and roll dreams come through. You were talking about...
Was that
about
after he shoved the table at you? Go ahead. Rock and roll dreams come through.
Do you mind if we talk about the music? Just briefly touch on it. I mean, I don't
no,
mind.
No, why? The music speaks for itself.
Oh, don't start all that. We don't need all that. That's for sure. Very cosmic. There's a line in that, angels had guitars before they had wings, which is just such a bit of a line. That, I'll give you that one. I'll give you credit for that.
You obviously
wrote that. Nothing to do with you.
Yeah, absolutely not, but you got to give him credit for that.
Because that is very creative.
I'll tell you what, he loved that line. Because the song is an older song, but that's a new verse in it. And he absolutely just, he came in. I remember him coming in, and we were cutting the track of Rock and Roll Dreams, and we had been working on it for like 2 days. And he comes in, and he never comes in excited except if he gets angry. And used to, he didn't get angry, which is like a new turn for him. I used to be the one that got angry all the time. And now then it's reversed. And, well, I still get angry, but I never saw him angry. But this particular day, he came in very excited. And for Jim, very excited is like, I have a great idea. Well, what is it, Jim? I got a new verse. Good, Jim. What is it? So that's excited for Jim. So he comes in and we go in and we add that verse. And I said, first time I heard it, I went, what? That was my reaction. What? He goes, no, it's really cool. It's double entendre and all this stuff. So I said, okay, double tundra is good for me. So it's there. And you picked it out, and you're the first person to ever mention it so far.
Right. You've come up with some...
you know what? If you open your mouth too many times, bugs going to start flying in there.
Some of the titles are wonderful. Good girls go to heaven, but bad girls go everywhere.
Yeah, he got that.
Is that from Jim's research or your research?
No, that's from a bumper sticker that are on New York taxi cabs. I swear, that was the first time I ever saw that. And then I said, Jim wrote a song. So I called him up and said, did you steal this title from a bumper? And he went, yeah. So I said, okay, that's fine. Well, I mean, objects in the rearview mirror may appear closer than they are. If everybody looks at their mirror, right, on your rearview mirror, that's what it says, only it doesn't say that.
But the line that isn't in that song should be, a friend of mine invented the rearview mirror, and he's never looked back, and it's not in there. I'm very disappointed.
A friend of mine
invented the rearview mirror, and he's never looked back. This quaint English humor, you probably haven't heard of it. Right.
Wait a minute. Stop. It's hard work, Mark. Stop for a second. Say that again. I want to hear this again.
A friend of mine invented the rearview mirror, and he's never looked back.
Is that funny?
Not really, because you're obviously not smiling deeply.
Is there a hidden meaning in there?
Yes, very. Double entendre, as
really?
Jim would say.
Oh, I see.
But not too excitable.
Well, see, but Jimmy's better than that, because, you see, objects in the rearview mirror may appear closer than they are is a mirror image to what's written on the mirror.
But isn't that Dashboard Light Part 2?
how do you get Dashboard Light Part 2 out of objects in the rearview mirror?
Because
have
it's
you heard
all
the
based
song?
On the same thing. Oh, no, I'm only allowed to hear bits of it because you won't let people hear anymore.
Well, you can't. It's not me, and I think you should be allowed to hear the thing. In fact, I think we should stop now and play it. This is stupid. So anyway, you haven't heard the whole song, so it can't possibly be. It's not even. It is in not even. It's not even in the same universe as Paradise by the Dashboard Light.
Why?
Because why? Because it's not. I don't know. What do you mean, why? Because it's a completely different song. It's a completely different meaning. It's a completely different time. It's a completely different character. Not even close to the same character. And that's how I judge it. It's not written in the same space. And why? Because it's completely different. That's like asking me, okay, Mars and Earth, why are they different? Because God made them that way. Why are they different? Because Jim Steinman made them that way.
You finished?
Yeah.
Calm down a bit now. Have another drink, for goodness sake. Right. Ireland, tell me about your memorable Irish tour. You played some stunning venues, I understand.
Oh, we did. We played I played 22 shows in Ireland. Did a 22 city.
So you played
tour.
To everybody in the entire country?
Just about, I think. And I would pull up to these places in the middle of a field, a huge barn. Had no electricity. I promise you this. This is a true story. And we did. One time, I remember, we pulled up. The bus stopped. The trucks carrying the lights and sound were all there. It was a big, like, shed. There was not a house you could see. Not one. And I looked around and I went, oh, okay. We're in a rural community here. So I went in. The sound and lights were set up. The crew was all sitting on the stage. And I said, well, are we ready to go? And they went, no. I said, why not? They said, well, there's no power in this building. So... It's a true story. And the promoter is running around going, but they promised me a generator in an Irish accent. I don't do an Irish accent. They promised me a generator. I wouldn't be lying to you. Now would I? So eventually we had a generator, but it was very late. But the funny thing was, is there was about 4,000 people showed up from nowhere. I mean, they like, you know, it was like, beam me in. It was like Star Trek time. And the cars, I figured I would be playing to sheep that night. A guy in his herd. I had to get one guy and 6,000 sheep. So, it was wild. That was a wild tour. And we did several of those kind of buildings. And we played another place. You'll like this. You'll appreciate this story. Where we were playing, they had these, in other words, in each village, the promoter seemed to get local promoters. It's probably the only local promoters, the only time they ever promoted anything. And they would have the venue, and they would do this. In the one particular town, we were promoted by the parish, the local church. So the lighting guys had a big ladder, and they had the ladder up, and they had focused some lights, and they left their ladder. And they came back. And the ladder was gone. They were going to move the ladder and scoot it over. And the ladder was gone. And so everybody was going, have you seen this ladder? No, we haven't seen the ladder. Where's the ladder? So somebody ran outside, and the priest was carrying the ladder, this big, giant ladder across the street. And so they stopped him, and he said, oh, I thought you wouldn't be needing this. Our ladder is broken, and it would go into God's service, this ladder. So he stole our lighting ladder. It was like this priest stole the ladder. Oh, I'm telling you, that's a tour of Ireland. I'm telling you, it is wild. And they would go, we'd say, how far is it from this place? Oh, it's 2.5 hours. But have you ever, I don't know how many people have ever been in Ireland.
I lived in Ireland for a year, so I know what you're talking
about. They have the smallest little roads that you can possibly have, and they're bumpy, and they're really windy, and we were trying to ride on a tour bus through here. They had to literally rope us down to keep us from flying about the bus. And the 2.5 hours every day would be six. And we were bouncing around. And I'm telling you, it was something else. It was wild. But I tell you what, the audience was terrific. And they were very appreciative. I think that's the right. Did I say that right? Appreciative. They were very, what were they? Very.
It's the standard of education in America. The colonies have never got it right.
No, no. It's the standard of education here. Now, you asked me, you want to talk about something here?
How do
you
spell
the
word?
How do you spell tire? Go ahead. Tell me how you spell tire.
T-Y-R-E?
Yeah, right. I'm not going to say another word. Thank you.
T-I-R-E.
Thank you. Not going to say another word. And say the word M-A-L-L. Go ahead. Go ahead. Say it.
Mal.
Thank you. Thank you. Okay. At least you didn't go Mal. Mal Smith is here. No. Okay.
The songs around this sort of project, and indeed the last project, are very theatrical. There's lots of characters in them. There's lots of work in them.
Well, that's exactly right. That, you know, you're very intelligent for an English guy, for this kind of schooling that you've had.
Yeah, it was good when it was approved, which you probably wouldn't understand. Have you...
No, I would. I saw that the other day, that the standard of English education has not kept up with the... But they say that in America all the time. Only in Somalia is their education level... Go ahead.
Thank you so much. Is that what appeals to some of it? That it is a lot of theatre and a lot of storylines and a lot of orchestration and a lot of, there's a lot to it.
Well, I tell you what, no, that's not the appeal. I'll tell you what the appeal is. That is the facade. That is, in other words, that's when you, it's like, it's in America, if you're going to look at a house to buy, they say it has curb appeal, right? You know, the front of it has the trees and the flowers and the beautiful little garden and the nice door or whatever it has, you know, curb appeal. Well, Bat Out of Hell had curb appeal, and I believe that Bat Out of Hell 2 has curb appeal. But it's what you get when you open the door that actually, that's the true test of selling a house. I've never done this one before. This is brand new. You get something different, a new analogy. So, but it's once you go in the house where, because all those things are the curb appeal. That's what you see on the outside. Theatrical, bombastic, over the top, all this stuff, self-indulgent, all those words go with it. And they're all compliments to us, by the way. But it's what you get when you go inside. And what you get when you go inside, it would be like if you went inside a house and you had great memories as a child living inside this, not this particular house, but a house very similar, and you walked around and you went from room to room and you got all these unbelievable emotional feelings and memories from your past, and they like swept over you and you went, man, wow, this bedroom is great, or look at this guy, oh, I remember this is like my grandmother's kitchen, and I remember sitting in my, you know, that kind of thing. Well, that's what you get when you walk inside this house. And what you get is you're not in the same room and you don't have the same thing, but you get a memory of that room and you get a feeling of a room from before and you get a feeling of warmth and you get a feeling of being overtaken by something and you feel like part of something, as opposed to being listening to me, or Jim doesn't write this way, so listening to us be internal and start telling you of our torment or our wonderful time in Cleveland or our wonderful time with this girl over here, when you can't actually be part of my wonderful time with this girl over here. And you know, and then you get, you know, you hear people go, she's got real angst inside that vocal. Yeah, and she's singing about something. And I'm not putting that down. I'm saying that's fine, but we live in a different world than that. What we do is we bring you in and we let you have your own memories and we let you have your own vision and we let you have your own responses. And I really, and people go, well, what is your image? And my answer to that is, I don't care what my image is. I only want you to care what your image is.
Interesting. But you've used the cliches, the sex and drugs and rock and roll and all those things. And songs have been written
by Jim. I
didn't
use them, Jim did.
Okay, Jim's. You sing them. All right, so you are slightly involved in this project. Do you think, I get very annoyed, I think, at a lot of the music I hear
today. No, it doesn't say sex and drugs.
I beg your pardon?
No, it says sex and drums.
And rock and roll.
Drums.
Well, I'll believe you then.
It doesn't say drugs. We never say the word drugs in
just this once. Okay.
No, we never say
I sex stand corrected.
And drums
I
and
do
rock
stand
and roll.
Corrected.
That's okay. We always turn right. into phrase. We never let it stand on its own.
Do you think that the days of the songwriter might be returning and that the sample and could be
oh, well,
going
I,
away?
I don't know. I'm not going to say that. I'm not going to say that because... I mean, this went on for a while with me and Jim. I wanted a live band. He wanted to go in and do, because he likes working that way. He likes working with the programmers and bringing in this guy and spending all this time on the bass drum and all this time. He likes to work like, Mutt Lang does with Def Leppard, or, Trevor Horn. There's nothing wrong with that. But I felt very strongly that all of these tracks, because I had waiting for him. There's another story. I'm going to go off here on you. I went out. I said, because we were going to start in May of '89 on this record, and so it was December. And I said, May? I thought we were going to start earlier. No, I can't be ready till May of '89. All right, then fine. So I called up my agent at William Morris, and I said, look. Jim can't be ready till May of '89, so why don't we go out for 6 weeks in February, like the for February and the beginning of March, and then we'll come back and I can get ready for him and I can do stuff. And so we decided we'd go out. So then we actually decided. I said, oh, forget it. Let's go out all the way till April. So we went out and we booked in America an 8-week tour, mostly a lot of colleges. Well, to end this story quickly. That was about 30 shows or 35 shows. I came off the road at 500 shows waiting for Jim. So my 35 shows turned into 500 until we started on the record. But it was very good because I learned an awful lot. And my answer to that is because it was right. It was the right time. And you said before, oh, that's real boring. But it's not boring, because in the process of when we were waiting, I learned. And that, I think that's the process of life, and I think that's what you're supposed to do, is you're supposed to learn. And so it happened when I was ready for it to happen, when the time was right. And so, I mean, I am very, right now, in the since 1988 through now, is probably the happiest time in my whole life. So I can sit in here, and I can joke with you, and I can... be in a really good mood, and instead of being, one of those, angst artists, I can be really. In fact, I got in an argument last night at this party, Bill Wyman's Sticky Fingers party, about with some guy, and he said to me, he had a couple of things to drink, so he was a little crooked, and. He said to me, why are you so happy? Well, it's weird, this guy. I said, because I'm secure. He goes, but you're a rock and roll guy. I said, yeah, that's right. He goes, well, you can't be secure. I said, I beg your pardon. And so I proceeded to give him a few lectures on security and a few lectures on rock and roll. And I shut him up after about a half hour, which I'm probably very capable of doing.
You shut him up or wore him down?
Either one. I wore him down, but that's either one. It's fine. No matter how it works. So anyway, that answered your first question. We were ready, and then I forgot your question that I was actually answering. Do you remember it?
No, I'm just enthralled with hanging on your every word. Acting has been quite an important part of your career. At one stage, I just thought you were becoming more of a media personality than, say, a rock and roll mercenary. You went off on this celebrity thing, and you weren't music. Why?
What do you mean? Well, I don't think there's anything wrong with that. Why? I don't have an answer. Why? You mean because I did that knockout thing for Prince Edward and stuff like that?
Oh, well, that's just mixing with royalty. I mean, you'd be into that because you're American.
Oh, well, no, it was like... You know that story? Do you know that story of me and Fergie? Because Fergie, was the captain of I was the captain of her team. Do you know that story? Because I said, I said, I can't walk around here for 5 days calling these people Your Highness. I said, it's not going to happen. I can't do it. So I just, like, didn't say anything. I'd go, uh-huh. Mm-hmm. I didn't open my mouth. Mm-hmm. So finally, she's looked over at me and went, oh, meaty. And I looked at her, or looked around trying to find who was saying meaty to me. And I'm going, oh, man, this is not going to do. And it was her. And so I said, wait a second, you can't call me that. And she goes, oh, but I must call you that. And I said, well, wait a second, babe. If you're going to call me that, then I'm going to call you something besides Your Highness. I got news for you. So she thought for a minute and she said, okay, you can call me Flower. So for the next 4 days, I went around going, yo, Flower, babe, over here. Let's go. Talk to me. You know, and her husband, Andrew, could hear this and was like, at one point he tried to shove me in a pool. And so I said, I wouldn't do that if I were you. I said, I wouldn't do this. I'm telling you right now. He says, and he looks at me, he goes, you can't touch me, you know. I said, you keep trying to shove me in a pool. I'll show you how fast I can touch you. And, you know, so it was one of those events. See, because I don't change wherever I go. I mean, it's like, that's why no matter what I do, I remain the same. I do not let anything trap me. And I think that it's very good and very healthy to do all kinds of things because it's all a learning experience. If you go and you do a big breakfast television, which I did the other day, and you go in and as a performer, and I think that there's nothing wrong with it to do any, as a performer, you feel, wait a second, let's look at this show. Because you go, all right, this show is having this pace. This show is doing this sort of thing. This show is doing this. All right. Now, I want to come across on this show. I don't want to step over the line on this show. But I want to go with the flow of the show. It's like doing a play. It's like going into a scene. If you go into a scene and you're not in the flow of the scene and you're not in the same world as the scene, you're going to look stupid. And you need to do that. And the one thing that I never want to look is stupid. Now, I may look silly, and I may look funny, and I may look all kinds of things, but I'll never look stupid because it's just a way of doing it. And I don't think there's anything wrong with going and doing Shakespeare, which I've done too, and I still want to do more. I don't think there's anything wrong with going and doing film or going on to do an improv National Lampoon show or going on to talk television or going on to, well, game shows I kind of have X'd. Just let you know that. Game shows I've decided I don't really like those. I did a couple, and I decided, nah, that's stupid. So, but you got to experience it to know whether it's stupid or not. You've got to have had the experience. You can't guess that it's stupid because you might be wrong. You have to prove it's stupid before you can actually say it's stupid. And I'm telling you that game shows are basically stupid. In fact, they wanted me to do a game show while I was here this time, and I said, nah, don't think so. And so, but I think everything else you do, whenever you go and do this interview I'm doing with you, you'll learn from it. You'll learn. So, I mean, I've already done something brand new, and that was the analogy of the house, which I thought was really good. I really like that analogy. So I learn all the time. My mind is in motion, except for when I go to sleep, and I can cut it off. But the rest of the time, my mind is in motion and never stops. And I'm always looking and seeing, and I watch like you, because I'll take this later, and I'll just what you're doing now, and I've watched it. You've been doing it for a while now. As a character inside a play, at some point, I'll be in a movie, and you watch. I will do this as a character, because I think it's really good. And by the way, you're on radio, so you're blind. You don't know what he's doing. But he's taking his pen, and he's turning it one way and then flipping it over and doing it the other way, like that. And I bet you money that one time you'll see me in a movie, and I'm going to be doing this because I watch mannerisms that people do, and you learn from it. And so I've just developed, and that's what Brando does, you see. When Brando goes in to do a film, before he ever tries to say a word or anything, he finds a mannerism to take with him inside that. Now, see, we're already getting a character out of this, and you can see him coming, you see. So we're building a character inside here.
So what you're saying is that the minute you leave your front door or go anywhere, there is no, it's a whole act. It's a whole, there isn't a genuine character. It's a whole act. You're stealing all the time from other people. The originality, there's no originality there.
Oh, you're completely loony. Because that's the stupidest thing. Now, that was stupid.
No, it wasn't. It was stupid. You're just telling me everywhere you go,
you
walk into the big breakfast and you take on a facade.
No, I don't take on a facade. That's not what I said. You didn't hear what I said. I said I feel the energy of it. I feel the pace of the show. I understand. You don't see. You don't even know what I'm talking about. You don't understand me. This is because you don't understand that level. And that's what I'm saying. If people are going to be performers, you now included, should learn this stuff. It is very important. If you're going to take on the role of an entertainer, are you an entertainer? Nah, you're an interviewer. You don't need this stuff. So anyway, but anybody that's going to do that, you need to know what situation you're in. You need to know how to analyze the situation because you don't want to be stupid. You want to be real. People think I'm real. I am real. There's never a moment in my life that I'm not real. It's like, again, I'm going to go back to De Niro. Do you think for a second that that character in Cape Fear that he did was not real? I don't believe that. That was a real character. But that wasn't Robert De Niro sitting in his front room watching the Australian test match, as he often does, I know. So, but those people are dead on real. And this is real. When I walk on a stage, when I sing my music, they're real. Those characters are real. And they're so real that sometimes they scare people. And they're so real that they overtake me. And when I was doing Life is a Lemon on this record, I had to switch characters because he could never finish the song because he was so angry. And the object of the song was not to be angry. The object of the song was to show anger as humor. And he was so angry that he couldn't sing the song. And Jim and I used to run them out of the studio. And Jimmy finally came to me and said, you know, maybe you should change this character. I said, I think you might be right when I wasn't singing the song. Because I build up to go into a studio. It is painful. This work is not easy. And to think for a second, it's real easy if you don't care. You know, it's real easy to be a star. But it's not easy to do the work. And to do the work and to do it real and to believe in it is very difficult. And it's a lot easier to do the work and do it right than it is to be a star. And that's what I'm about. I'm about the work and I'm about it being real.
But I wanted...
And he's trying to wind me up.
But I wanted a statement from you and you just gave me exactly what I wanted. So thank you very much. You're very kind. It's interesting that there is an idea that I heard, I don't know whether this is true or not, you were going to premiere the album and the show and do some shows in London and do some shows in America. Is that going to happen or are you going to tour with this show?
Oh, I'm touring. I'm doing 60 warm-up dates.
Are you that bad?
No. I'm doing them around the world. I mean, I'm going literally around the world. Like, I'm coming into England for 11 shows, and to me, that's a warm-up for the U.K., I mean, 11 shows. To most people, 11 shows. You know, if you're an American, or if you're even some, you know, 11 shows in the UK is, to me, is a warm-up. Because I've spent, like, 8 weeks in the UK before. I've gone to everywhere. And so when I come and do 11 shows in a place, or I do 3 shows in Germany, or I go into Copenhagen for one time, or I go into Amsterdam, those aren't tours. Most people, they consider those
tours.
Yeah,
but that's really unfair, because if you go into Copenhagen and do one show, how many of the population can see you, and that so many of those people bought the record to allow you to do those shows, so that's unfair.
Oh, he's just trying to wind me up in here. Can you believe this guy?
But that is unfair.
Oh,
you're
man.
Telling me you're the man of the people, and now you won't go and play to them. You play one show in Denmark.
But when we come back in March, we will probably play 6 or 7.
My, that's generous.
It is very generous of me. It is very generous. But you can only play so much at the start. You can only go, and I'm trying to go around the world. I'm going around the world in 60 shows. It's around the world in 60 days. Get it? Or did you not get that? You didn't get that, did you?
Just looking for the creativity you've been telling me about here. I'd do anything for love, but I won't do that. A very powerful element. Are you a romantic?
Absolutely. He's really trying to get me in here, isn't he? Well, I'm not going to let you. Ha, 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 ha. Go ahead.
Oh, that's the question. Are you a romantic person?
I answered yes.
Was that it?
That's it. That's it.
Well, I thought it better than that.
Well, you could have had you not been trying to wind it around.
The British audience...
You're fooling with a different animal now,
will
son.
Will you shut up for a minute? The British audience appear to have been very loyal to you. Have they been loyal to you, the Brits?
Yeah, absolutely.
And they've supported you. Rock and roll mercy. We put that in the chart with old John Parr. What a fine Yorkshire lad. You know, you see, there's good blood in your act somewhere. Mm. So, we've been very loyal and very supportive.
Absolutely.
Do you feel that from the British audience?
Absolutely. Oh, I'm here a lot. I do a lot here. I do more here than I do anywhere. So there.
And you're going to in the future?
Not after talking to you. You're it for me, boy. You're it, son. That's it. I'm out of here on you. No, I'm kidding.
There must surely not be another sequel. You can't get away with three.
Oh, I wouldn't. I have no idea. But right now, I would agree with you. I mean, I would say I wouldn't do Battle Hell 3.
You mean you would agree with you couldn't get away with three? Or you'd agree with
you
couldn't do three?
It's not get away with it. It's not a matter of get away with it. It's a matter of artistically it wouldn't be correct at this point in time. But if it was 15 years from now, I might argue with you. What is that noise? I found a noise that I didn't know existed. What is that? Oh, man, it's a glued table.
Evidently, so, don't worry about it, because the pencil noise is so noisy, we won't be able to hear anything else.
There you go.
So it's, how long in and we decided that we're going to start rolling the pencils?
So anyway. You didn't say anything before.
Well, there's no point trying to tell you anything, is there?
There is a point in trying to tell me anything. So anyway, no, but you want to know why we called it Battle of Hell 2?
That is pretty, isn't it?
Do you want to know why?
Go on, then.
A marketing tool. So that people would go, oh, is that the same guys? Is that those same two guys that did Bat Out of Hell? That's it, right there. There's not another reason other than doing that, calling it Bat Out of Hell 2, and then Back into Hell says to you, wait a second, and all I'm trying to do is bring back you into the world of knowing what that is. No, I'm not. I need things to play with. You couldn't hear that. Give me that. Give me that back. You couldn't hear that. Could you hear that? No, see, give me that lid back.
That'll do.
Give me my lid back.
Thank you! Now, I know you're not going to be out. That's it, I don't want to talk to you anymore. Do you want to, will you do me a quick...
What do you mean, that's it?
Yeah.